Paul Edmonds has spent more than 2,000 games behind the mic calling baseball play-by-play. Paul, how did you and baseball fall in love?
Well, kind of a unique story. I think that everybody probably has one when you get to this point. I love the game growing up. I mean, for me, as much as I enjoyed hockey, and we all do here, baseball was my summer sport, and I wasn't great at it, that's for sure, but I really enjoyed it, and I think part of it was there was an allure there where, you know, the Yankees of the 70s with Reggie Jackson and all those teams, they were only on TV sporadically, so there was the Saturday afternoon baseball and then the World Series time, and my father introduced me to the game for sure, just like a lot of other dads have, playing catch in the backyard. And from that standpoint, I played till I was, I think, 15, and then got a part-time job, and that kind of rendered me from being able to continue to play. But in my career, the most interesting part of that was I was working for the Regina Pats in the Western Hockey League. And it was a per-game basis. So while I was paid okay enough to make a living, in the summer they would cut me loose. And I heard about a job in Lethbridge, Alberta, when I was working in Regina, from a friend that I knew from Swift Current. Connect the dots here in a minute. The Lethbridge team, that was the Lethbridge Mounties, they're now defunct, but they were in the Pioneer Baseball League, a league really of teams in Montana, Idaho, and Utah. They were looking for a radio play-by-play guy on a 72-game schedule. So I actually applied for the job with a hockey demo tape. So figure this out. I applied for a baseball play-by-play job on the radio with a hockey tape. But really what he was looking for was just some fluidity, how you sounded, if you could get through it. And so I got the job. So I took the job in 1994 in Lethbridge. And the interesting part was, I think for a lot of us, we all think we know the game until you either have to umpire it, officiate it, or broadcast it. And then it gets more complicated. And I remember the station manager who hired me was there for the first game that I did, and he came walking into the press box at one point and turned up the crowd mic on me because there was a lot of dead air in between pitches. And I realized, Ron, real quick, that that was the art of baseball broadcasting, filling that time. So from there, I always tell people I've had two baseball jobs in my career. One I quit to take the other, and then I resigned to take the job with the Jets from the Winnipeg Goldeyes. But that really spawned my career back at home. I was able to kind of really earn my spurs in Southern Alberta and get to the point where by the time the job opened up a year later in Winnipeg, I just kind of waltzed right into it with some help from Sam Cates.
In these days, people are used to baseball broadcast teams, two, three guys in a booth. You always worked alone, and I know you preferred it that way. Why?
Well, I think sometimes the game can get a little cumbersome with the back and forth. It was radio. I treated it kind of like it was sports talk, and I put a lot of time into reading and learning about players and sharing stories. And I thought if I could storytell along and sprinkle in what was going on the field, that you were more apt to listen and maybe even a little bit more acutely to your radio. So it just became something that as I moved along, and you were forced to in minor league baseball, a lot of times teams didn't have the money to pay for two guys or three guys. So you were there to do it alone because that's all they had the budget for. So by the time you maybe as the Goldeyes grew and probably had the budget for an extra guy, I was already very comfortable in doing it myself. So that's what I did. And now I would bring in guests, and I enjoyed guests to come in and had a lot of them, Don Cherry and Pete Rose, and the list goes on, all kinds of Olympians, Canadian Olympians from Manitoba. So it just became sort of the way I did it and the way I was most comfortable with it. And I think that as long as you were going back and forth with intersprinkling each pitch with a story or some sort of stat or something relative to the game, that I think that you kind of hit the mark, and I hope I did that over the course of my 20 years.
You're well known, renowned in fact, for your joy, your enthusiasm, and the outright unabashed passion that you bring to the microphone, whether it's baseball or hockey. I'm thinking now of a baseball season, 100, 110, 115 games spread over. Most recently, the footprint you traveled was Texas to Winnipeg, which is a fairly big footprint. Did it ever get old? You ever get tired? Was it hard to get up some nights?
It wasn't hard to get up some nights for the game or to do your job. It was hard sometimes to leave your family. That was the toughest part.
Yeah, I can understand that. You're also famous for your unique signature calls, especially your home run call. Tell me about how you came to that.
Well, I figured at some point I needed some, as you mentioned, signature. I needed something unique, something that would distinguish you between somebody else and already established in the game. So I was just kind of driving one day and I need a home run call. And it was kind of in between Lethbridge and moving to Winnipeg. And I said, okay, well, kiss it goodbye. It was, okay, so how can I add on to this? Well, just kind of almost an alliteration or some sort of a rhyme. You can look up, pucker up, and kiss it goodbye. And hey, wait a minute, I'm onto something here. And it was spawned driving a vehicle. I don't even know what vehicle I had at the time, but it was in driving some highway or somewhere along the lines on a road. And that's what I came up with. Now, the key to that was being comfortable in using it and not making second guessing yourself if somebody was going to like it or not, or if they thought it was stupid, right? So I just kind of went with it and people liked it and I just stuck with it and became my call. Now, I only used it for Goldeye's home runs. I never used it for opposition home runs. That was the other part of this was if somebody hit a home run off of one of the Goldeye's pitchers, it was just back and gone, right? But when it was a Goldeye, it was you can look up, pucker up, and kiss it goodbye.
You saw a number of great players throughout your career, whether it was here in Alberta, wherever. Tell me about some of them who popped to mind, just right off the top of your head.
Well, I think of guys like Carmen Cappuccio, just 1 year with the Goldeyes. But this was a guy that was so close to Major League Baseball in the White Sox system. He got hung up and behind on the depth chart of all people. Michael Jordan. When Michael Jordan left basketball to go to baseball, Carmen was back in behind him. And he got put back in queue behind arguably the greatest basketball player of all time. So, but you could see why the skill set almost got him there. And it wasn't for that act of fate, you know, he probably would have because he was just a great player. Talk about Terry Lee, two-time MVP in the Northern League in the early years. He was, you know, on the on-deck circle in the World Series in 1990 with the Cincinnati Reds. You can see why he got there, the way he played first base and swung the bat. You know, there was some great local players. Donnie Smith, I mean, you know, there's another kid now that Ryan Johnson, I think is his name, that's hoping to do the exact same thing, but some great players. You know, all those St. Paul Saints guys, they had just a wealth of those guys, the Strawberries, the Jack Morrises, J.D. Drews, always great stories with those guys as well. So the fact that it was minor league baseball and independent at that did not relinquish the fact that there was great players that came through that we were able to watch in southern Manitoba over the years and still to this day. Reggie Abercrombie's another one. Now, I never got to call his games with the Winnipeg Goldeyes, but I certainly did when he was with Sioux Falls, so I'm well versed on the impact that he has made in the years that he's been here in Winnipeg.
Well, you've left the baseball microphone behind. You haven't left baseball behind. You're still involved.
I am. Probably more joy than I get out of really, and anybody that knows me knows that I have a passion for the outdoors. I like to walk in the field. I like to fish. But I have been able to, and this is my sixth year since leaving the Goldeyes, I've been able to coach my older boy in baseball for two, and now I've dropped down to coach my younger guy for the last four. So I have found that really rewarding. I really enjoy working with the kids. I think I have something to bring from all the years that I sat around with Hal Lanier and Rick Forney and Bob Kipper and Tom Vaith and watched how they conducted themselves or what they were teaching, what they were talking about, and just using that resource to take that to hopefully help our kids get a little bit better at the game overall. So yeah, I've stayed in the game quite actively. I really enjoy coaching now, Ron. It's a real passion of mine now.
Manitoba Baseball Hall of Fame now for you. What are you feeling? Got to be a special moment.
Oh, for sure. Humbled. The reflection of what 20 years that, I mean, absolutely zoomed by. The sacrifices that were made, not just by me, but by everybody with me, you know, the family dinners and the birthdays and the reunions and all those things that I missed. This is as much of an acknowledgement for them as it is for me. It's nice to be recognized for your career in a sport. I'm going to mention this when I get up to speak tonight. I don't think anybody, and I truly mean this, gets involved in this sport or a sport with the vision of getting into the Hall of Fame. You know, so it just happened. And I think when anything happens organically, that's when it's the most rewarding. And that's what that is for me, or what this is for me. And again, by extension, it's not just an acknowledgement for me, it's for my family and everybody that, you know, I touched. And the other part of it is too, it makes me remember all the great relationships that I've had through the game, including yourself. You know, John Hindle and Andrew Collier, Scott Nealis and Donnie Smith and the Fortin brothers and guys I still keep in contact with today. I mean, it's about that camaraderie and the relationships and the friendships that I've made over that 20 years. Invaluable.
Member of the Manitoba Baseball Hall of Fame, Paul Edmonds.